is an Unspoiled Network podcast.
This is Unspoiled, covering the Dresden Files, Book 4, Summer Night, Chapters 1, 2, and 3. In these chapters, Harry Dresden gets visited by a fairy queen, and it doesn't go super well. Ever for him. I can end every intro with "it doesn't go super well." Welcome to Unspoiled.
Yeah, it doesn't go well.
You sure don't. And you know what also didn't go well? Ordering this fucking book on Amazon.
Oh my God, you guys, can we tell you?
This is such a fucking saga. It's so stupid.
This bullshit here. All right, so first Natasha ordered it to come to my house.
Mm-hmm.
And they lied.
They straight
liar,
up lied.
Liar, pants on fire.
Not just once either. Twice they tried to say.
So then you went back and you were like, fuck that, reship it to this address. You gave him my work address.
What it was the first time they tried to say, oh, we tried to deliver it and we couldn't, which Rashawn got.
Labor Day, I was home.
Right. And I know what everybody's thinking, Labor Day, you're not supposed to get mail on Labor Day. Well, they said they tried to. So if they didn't, they lied. I don't know what to tell you. And the second day, Rashawn got a delivery of a new headset. Which is much larger than a little paperback book.
A whole fucking package.
Yeah.
Left for me downstairs, all unsecure. Luckily, no one stole it. It was there.
It was right
there. Where was my little book? Not there.
So then I go on the tracking site, and they're like, hey, we tried to deliver this twice, but if you want to give us a new address, and we can, like, try that other address, I guess. And I'm like, okay, I guess I'll send it to Rashawn's new job, since she says that it's okay to get packages there sometimes.
And it is.
So I put in that address. And they're like, yeah, okay, sure, we'll deliver it tomorrow. Which I was like, tomorrow? You can do that? All right, well, all right, do it tomorrow. This was all online. Well, like 3 days go.
Nothing.
The weekend goes. Nothing. She comes home today and there's a fucking notice on her home mailbox. After I try to redirect this fucking thing to a different address, now they're still trying to deliver it to her home address.
Yeah.
What the fuck?
So now tomorrow we get to go to the post office to see if it's in fact actually there, even though it's supposed to be delivered at my work address.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, all week I've been side-eyeing the girls downstairs. So I'm like, I know y'all got my fucking package. Why didn't y'all give it to me?
Oh, shit. They're like, why does she hate us?
I know, right? I'm like making friends. Yeah, I'm not making friends.
Oh, my God. That's so funny. So, yeah. I am just fucking irritated. We try to do, because Chris Tex has access, I think it's actually Bitches, who has this like amazing Dropbox file with hundreds, maybe thousands of Kindle books. And I was able to send myself the Kindle version of this book and it works fine. It's gorgeous. It opens up, the chapters are all set and everything. There's another, like, I've had a couple from that folder that don't work. And the formatting's weird and whatever, but this book is fine. Tried it, nothing.
Nothing.
Like, so I don't know why.
Was like, well, download Audible and I can send you my file.
Mm-hmm.
So I download Audible, but I don't get anything. But I got a credit for downloading Audible. So I was like, fuck it, I'll just buy the goddamn book. Fuck it. I buy the book, and 30 minutes later, I get a message. Natasha sent you a book. After I've already fucking spent my credit on the book. I'm so worried.
Thankfully, if you go on audible.com, like on your desktop, returning a book on there is super, super easy.
Yeah.
So you'll get a credit back. But like, seriously, this should not have been the issue that it was.
And meanwhile, because I'm not used to this. This is the first audiobook I've ever listened to, and it really does not work well for me, guys. As I said, my message, I'm not really, my auditory comprehension is lacking. It always has been. Mm-hmm. I do much better reading from a textbook than I do listening to a lecture. So I listened to the audiobook, and then as we were getting prepared to record, I was like, well, let me go online and see if I can find like crib notes because I need something to refer to.
Mm-hmm.
And the first three chapters are available online. I could have just did that shit from the jump.
Oh, you know.
So,
meanwhile, people who are like 5-6 years younger than us are like, of course they're available online, you fucking idiots. I'm like,
no one asked you guys.
We're dumb, okay? Shut up. But yeah, there's like, you know, you can torrent stuff, but like I forgive me. Things don't work for Rashawn.
They really don't.
They just don't.
I tell you guys,
you know, like this, like I said, sending the file to just an email address and it popped up on my Kindle just fine. Mm-hmm. No problems at all.
And for her, it doesn't work. I sent myself something on my Kindle and it worked just fine. But I couldn't get the one from you.
I should have just sent you the file and you could have emailed it to yourself.
Maybe.
Whatever. Anyway. So guys,
all that to say, this was a ginormous pain in the dick.
Yeah, it was, which is why we missed last week. Sorry, everybody. We really just, they kept saying the book was on its way. The book was on its way. So we kept thinking up until the last second on Friday, oh, well, she's getting it today, so she'll be able to read it. And finally,
and real talk, we almost missed tonight because I was not in the mood.
Fair. I mean, after what we went through this afternoon,
it
was just so fucking irritating. You just get so mad. Things shouldn't be this hard.
And I know that they're just this hard for me. And part of me is like, well, I'm doing something wrong. And granted, I probably am. But I swear to God, guys, in real life, I am slightly above competent. I promise you. I promise you I am.
All right. So, but what did you think of the audiobook despite, like, other than comprehension being difficult? Because
I love listening to James read.
You totally went away there for a second. Come back.
Loved listening to James read it.
Oh, okay, cool.
Because I'm not used to it, it was difficult to keep up when he's switching characters.
Oh, gotcha.
And some characters' names sounded kind of the same to me, and I wasn't sure who he was talking about.
Mm-hmm.
And then once I went online, I was like, oh, those names are super similar. But all that aside, I just love his voice so much.
Yeah, he has and a hell of a voice.
He really gets into it, you know? He's like switching around. Now he's this guy. Now he's fucking Dresden. Now he's not.
Mm-hmm.
It's fun.
Yeah, and these first three chapters actually have like less of that than a lot of the book does.
Yeah.
Because there'll be people later with like really pronounced accents or weird voices.
It seemed like these first three were kind of, and I needed them, were like kind of catch you up kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So that was good.
Yeah. So on that note, first chapter, it rained toads the day the White Council came to town.
That too. I love that. Did you ever watch Magnolia?
No.
I love this.
That's Tom Cruise going bananas, right?
There is Tom Cruise in it. I'm not a huge fan, though it is one of my favorite Tom Cruise performances.
Okay. Did he win an Academy Award for that?
I think he was nominated. I don't think he didn't win. But it's a beautiful movie. I love it. It's a, what's his name? Paul Thomas Anderson movie. Boogie Nights and what else did he do?
I haven't seen Boogie Nights either.
Punch Drunk Love and fucking No Country for Old Men, I want to say.
Haven't seen any of those. Well, shit.
Oh, shit. Well, I like him. I'm a big fan of his. And Magnolia is a wonderful movie with a gorgeous soundtrack. And whatever I think of Raining Frogs makes me think of it because that's kind of how the movie ends.
Okay.
And it was the first time I became aware of, and I'm not going to say it right, what is that phrase, the way Greek plays would end?
Deus ex machina?
Is that how you say it? Deus ex machina?
Deus ex machina.
So this is what I think of when I think of frogs falling from the sky.
Okay.
But I've never encountered it at the beginning of a story before.
Well, Deus Ex Machina tends to be a quick and easy way to get yourself out of a literary corner.
Mm-hmm.
You write yourself into a spot where there's nowhere you can go, and you're just right. And Superman saved them. The end.
Exactly.
And this doesn't really fall in that category because it's just starting things off.
The whole story is starting with frogs flying from the sky.
Mm-hmm. An increasing intensity. Like later on, it gets pretty gross.
Right. You have to watch Magnolia because when the frogs start to fall, it is super gross.
Ew.
Like the splattering on car window shields. And like,
I don't want to see Magnolia now. Why are you telling me this? I don't want to watch frog murder. That's not why I go to the movies. You're like acting like this is going to be a draw for me. I don't know who you think you're talking to, lady.
Right. My mistake. So this is how it opens.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he gets hit on the head with one.
Yep.
Got hit on the head by something damp and squishy. I flinched and slapped at my hair. Something small fell past my face and onto the ground at my feet. A toad. Not a big one, as toads go. It could easily have sat in the palm of my hand. It wobbled for a few moments upon hitting the ground, then let out a bleary croak and started hopping drunkenly away. And he's in the middle of, looking around and absorbing this when Billy the Werewolf walks up, whom you did not remember.
I didn't. I had to message him. Who the fuck is... Because the way he says, 2 years ago, blah, blah, blah. I'm like, is that one of the kids from the Alphas? But mm-hmm. The way he describes them is so physically different.
Yeah.
But that's exactly who it is.
Yeah, he's grown into himself because he used to be a pudgy, nerdy sort of teen. And he's lost all that weight, gained a ton of muscle, and just in general is a lot more self-possessed because his skill is under control.
Yeah, he's really grown into himself, whatever this new version of himself is. And he seems to have a pre-existing relationship with Harry that we are not quite aware of yet.
Mm-hmm.
Which I thought was fun because you feel like you've been with Harry throughout these three books and you know everything there is to know.
Mm-hmm.
But it still turns out there are parts of his life that we don't know about yet.
Yeah, that's something that'll consistently happen is a lot of the books, there is a several month gap between the end of the previous and the beginning of the next one. And the way that Butcher tells the story is he'll pick up and sort of drop in a character as if Harry's been hanging out with him and we just haven't seen it. Or Harry has known this person and we just didn't realize.
Yeah.
I
really appreciated that, too. I did. At one point, he's like, I went and got your messages. And me as a reader, I'm like, the fuck did you get keys to the office? but apparently that's something that has happened while we weren't looking.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so he's like, mentions something. He says, we run into a lot of odd things lately when we're out patrolling. Patrolling? Holy vigilantes, Batman.
No shit. Oh, my kid. Can I stop you?
Yeah. Of
listening
course.
Listening to James Marsters read that line about patrolling, I was like, you don't know what that is.
That's true.
Right?
That's true. I wonder if when he reads about the vampire stuff, he can't, if he giggles to himself.
I hope so. I really hope so.
So they're just talking about how basically, if these toads turn out to be real, then things are in a bad way. Because Harry wants to collect them to test mm-hmm. whether or not. And if they aren't real, then it's probably just a trick because fairies get bored and just do shit because they just like to mess with humans. And that's what Harry's hoping this is. Which later on, it turns out it is not.
Because doesn't one shit in his hand?
Mm-hmm. Yep, because he's holding it and squeezing the poor thing as he's fighting later on. And when they've gotten, they've gotten started collecting toads in a bag for him to take a look, Billy basically is like, hey, so why don't you come and hang out with us? We're going to be playing you know, an RPG game. And Harry is really withdrawn and reticent and getting irritable about Billy's questions about the toads and stuff, much more than really is warranted.
Mm-hmm.
And then we get kind of a picture of the fact that Harry hasn't been, you know, showering, doing his laundry, shaving, feeding himself, paying his bills.
His whole self go in this, what we find out later is this, like, sort of super focus on, I think, trying to save Susan.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Not that he has seen her, not that she's around, but so because he has respected the fact that she asked him to leave him alone. But he figures that she asked him that because she's ill. And if he can fix that, then all is going to be fine. And when Billy first brings this up, Harry first of all tries to deny it. Then he starts to get irritated because Billy starts talking about the war with the vampires and what happened to Susan without really knowing what happened to Susan.
Right.
And so pushing a little harder than he would, I think, if he realized what a sensitive issue this is.
Yeah. He's like just blundering through. He's got no sensitivity. He's not trying to couch anything to not upset Harry. He's just like rattling it off like it's news at 6 o'clock.
Yep.
Which is fine for someone who wasn't there, but if you're talking to someone who was there,
yeah,
you might want to be a little bit more careful.
Yeah. And when Harry just says drop the subject, Billy says, no, Harry, damn it, you vanish from the face of the earth. You're hardly showing up at your office, won't answer your phone, don't often answer your door. We're your friends, and we're worried about you. Word is that the Reds are bringing more muscle into town, that they're offering their groupies full vampirehood if one of them brings you down. It's not a good time for you to be outside by yourself, even during daylight. And at this point, he says, I don't have time. And Billy is like, oh, BT Dubs, I made an appointment with you with a client. And Harry starts to get really irritated. Yes. Basically, like, you're getting up in my business. And Billy's like, yeah, I am getting up in your business because you're about to lose your office. You're about to get evicted. Like, you need somebody looking into your business since you're not going to do it. And they're in the middle of this big fight. And I love this. I reached down and snatched up a toad, jerking the cloth bag from Billy's hands. I don't need you. Naturally, the hit went down right then. So, throughout this conversation, there has been a woman circling them with a grocery cart.
Yeah, some sort of, like, harmless transient, you're supposed to think, right? Even though I feel like I have to say, you know, as soon as she's introduced, that she's not what she appeared.
Right. She gets mentioned too many times, too. Like, even if you didn't catch it the first time that he mentions her, once she's like, oh, the woman went by us. The woman went by us again. And I'm like, why is she circling you?
Why do you keep drawing attention to this woman?
Yeah. And he still doesn't even notice her because the first hit comes from the front from a pickup truck that just comes screaming up onto the grass in the park, and they just open fire.
Yeah.
And Harry is using his shield, and he is using a lot of energy to keep the shield up, too much for him to be able to guard against the woman who shows up from behind them. And it turns out she's like in age makeup and everything.
Yeah.
And Billy transforms and attacks her, and it turns out that she is not a woman. She is a ghoul. Which I don't, have we met a ghoul before?
I don't think so.
No, I don't think so either.
The only ghoul I can think of is the one that lives at the Weasleys.
Oh my god, yeah, that's true.
It's an entirely different thing, I think.
Yeah, the ghoul, it's just like basically all that ghoul does is just make noise and moan. But
Yes.
ghouls in this world are supes dangerous. They like to eat people. And then her hands distended, lengthening, as did her shoulders and her jaw. Her nails became ugly, ragged talons, and she raked them down at Billy, striking him across the jaw, this time eliciting a pained yelp mixed with a snarl. He rolled to one side and came up on his feet, circling in order to force the woman things back to me. The woman whipped around to face me, her face distorted, features furious, mouth drooling around tusk-like fangs. And he shoots her straight in the belly. And she basically goes down for a second, comes right back up again, and runs for that truck and jumps in the truck, and they go like screeching away down the road.
Yeah.
But, you know, he nails her full on in the gut, and she's gonna be fine, which is really scary. Like,
Yeah, this is and again, I don't know exactly the difference between ghouls and ghosts yet. It's at least as far as this book is concerned. But the fact that he nails her dead on in the gut and she doesn't even miss a beat makes me think this is something entirely different.
He compares ghouls to cockroaches.
Oh, I hate it.
Yeah, he's
I
like
hate it.
they basically you almost can't kill them. Like
Oh,
they're
yeah, I don't
just
like
so difficult to kill.
it.
And also he makes note of one of the kids in the truck that goes after him is like super young. He's about 18 years old, maybe.
And this kid that's 18 is human, though, right?
That kid was human, I think, yeah. So they're all working together one way or another, at least for now. Like, who knows if they
Yeah.
succeeded, if she would have eaten him.
Right. But that's new too, though, the idea that ghouls and humans can work together.
Yeah, I mean, like, ghosts at least aren't corporeal.
Right.
So the ghouls clearly are.
Yeah. And it's and like from the last book, ghosts, though they can be sort of controlled or summoned by humans or wizards, they don't, like you said, they don't work in league with them. Like once you summon them up, they just kind of do what they're going to do.
Yeah, I guess so. Like,
It's a little bit different.
yeah, it's I'm not sure if we have like a firm answer on how that works or if we've just seen like one example of it.
Well, yeah, that's fair. We only saw the one example from the last book. I don't know if that carries over.
Because, yeah, Harry just like releases them basically and lets them attack, and they just are in the right place for that. I don't know if he could have like made them attack.
And even if you think of what Kravis was able to do as far as like unleashing them and like riling them up, they sort of kind of went out on their own to cause whatever mayhem they were going to cause.
Yeah, that's true.
This sort of getting away together in a getaway car is entirely
Yeah.
new.
Yeah. So yeah, it seems like ghosts maybe just don't have the ghosts aren't present, right? They're just kind
Right.
of operating on this vague, and ghouls are a real being that exists in our world and can shapeshift, which is also not great. Don't like that.
Yeah, I don't care for this.
So they run to the beetle and get in, and toads really start coming down now. And they leave like cracks on the windshield and fucking, generally lose their shit. And Harry's like, "So, when was that appointment you set up? No big deal, whatever, but I just thought I'd ask. For you. I don't care.
It's
I'll go because
not
you
that I need rent money,
right? It
but
just
it's
it
kind of
sounds like it's
bad.
really important to you." So he goes and drops Billy off. And when he looks in the mirror, in the rearview mirror of his car, he's really blown away because he doesn't keep mirrors in his house. He says too many things could use them as windows, even doors. And it was a risk I preferred to skip entirely. I hadn't glanced at a mirror in weeks. I looked like a train wreck.
More so than usual. I really laughed at that. I'm sorry.
Yeah, he's just my, I had circles under my eyes. My hair had grown out, and it wasn't like that sexy young rock star kind of way, but in that time to take Rover to the groomer kind of way. It didn't even have the advantage of being symmetrical, since a big chunk had been burned short in one spot when a small incendiary had been smuggled to me in a pizza delivery box. Back when I could still afford to order pizza.
I love that pizza box callback.
Yep. My skin was pale, pasty even. I looked like death warmed over, provided someone had made death run the Boston Marathon. And he's realizing how bad this is. But he doesn't have time to, like, dwell on it before he goes to his meeting. So when he meets his client, this is what he looks like. He's also in sweatpants. Like, it's no bueno. And he is thinking, as he's sitting in his car, about Susan and that Billy had been right and how he's been trying to do this research. And as he starts thinking about her, he just continually thinks there's something that I can do. There has to be something I can do. And starts crying and breaks down. Yeah.
Even though I'm not surprised, I am really glad that they carried on with this particular part of the story, that Harry would be obsessed with trying to find something to save Susan.
Mm-hmm.
Because it makes sense. And if they had left this out in favor of just jumping into whatever this book's going to be about, mm-hmm. I would have been disappointed.
Yes, agreed. I think that's something that the series is much better with than I really expected going into it, because the first books are so... My mom read the first book for the first time like a week ago. And she said, oh, it's like candy for your brain. And I was like, it is initially. And it starts to get much more nourishing than that. Mm-hmm. He is not afraid to really dig into the emotional repercussions of things that happen in a way that feels more human, right, than what we're used to seeing a lot of times when it comes to paranormal, you know, wizardry stuff.
Yeah, I totally agree. Because it would have been probably easier to write this book if Harry was just 100% focused on whatever this obstacle was going to be for this book. But to carry over his unfinished business from the last book, and to carry over how completely devastated he was that he couldn't save Susan immediately,
mm-hmm.
you know, to me lends something to this character.
And it's just, you know, it's nice to know that he can't suffer something so fucking traumatizing and just bounce back from it.
Right, right. Which I think is a mistake that a lot of heroes fall prey to.
Mm-hmm.
This idea that because they're heroic, that means they just keep moving forward and they never look back.
Mm-hmm.
Which, granted, is probably a good thing to have, that you look forward. But it makes me feel like part of you is not sympathetic if you're not haunted by what you missed last time.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. It makes you feel less relatable, the character mm-hmm. does. And it also makes you feel like there aren't as many stakes, because no matter what happens, they're going to be fine.
Yeah.
They're going to come back from it, you know? Knowing that this really made an impression on him that is still fucking with him to the point where his friends are stepping in to do basic shit for his life to continue. That's pretty intense.
Yeah, I agree.
So finally, he goes into the appointment. He's notices a weird shock when he touches the doorknob. And when he goes inside, he, like, looks around for a second at how much of a complete disaster his office is. It's the kind of disaster where he apologizes to the person waiting for him, because there is, like, the smell of burnt coffee, like he left the burner on at mm-hmm. one point. There is all of his file cabinet drawers are open with, like, a bunch of the folders standing up out of them or put in wrong or whatever. There are, the place is just dusty and gross. It's just really bad. It looks like he looks. And he stops dead and says, "In the ruins of my office stood a woman with the kind of beauty that makes men murder friends and start wars."
Mm-hmm.
And this is one of the few moments where I don't mind him describing how a woman looks in detail. Because, as it turns out, this lady is not a real person.
Yeah.
So her unearthly beauty is actually kind of important. And I love, like, because this is something that I kind of enjoy in particular about Butcher's writing, is that when he's not, you know, focusing way too much on women's bodies, he actually notices fashion to a degree and, like, can get very detailed about what a person is wearing,
mm-hmm.
which is something that I really like as somebody who focused on costuming in school for a while.
Yeah. I feel too, the person he's about to introduce us to after he gets done, you know, running down what she looks like,
mm-hmm.
is of enough importance that she deserves this type of detailed introduction.
Right. I agree. So he says she had white hair, not white blonde, not platinum, white as snow, white as the finest marble bound up like a captured cloud to bear the lines of her slender throat. I don't know how her skin managed to look pale beside that hair, but it did. Her lips were the color of frozen mulberries, almost shocking in a smooth and lovely face, and her oblique eyes were a deep green that tinted to blue when she tilted her head and looked me over. She wasn't old, wasn't young, wasn't anything but stunning.
Mm.
And she's wearing a charcoal gray suit and opals and generally has the look of somebody who has lots of money.
Right. I love that detail.
So he's just like,
even though I don't know anything about how the White Council works, she should of course look like she's losing money.
Yep.
And he's a peasant. It just makes sense.
Wait, did you say the White Council?
Isn't she from the White Council?
No, she's a fairy.
Wait. I'm getting my people confused. Who is he describing now? Is it Maeve or Mob?
This is Mab.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Sorry. Wrong person.
So, yeah, she is basically disdainful is the word. From the moment that he begins to talk, the first thing she says is, "I believe you are late." And when he offers her coffee, she says that it sounds less than sanitary. Why should I take the risk? Which I really enjoy. That she's just really leaning into shaming him for being late, for his office being a mess, for him looking like shit. Whereas somebody like me would try and be polite and then save my disdain for after I walked out the door. She's just putting it right out there. Yeah, like, oh, this looks real bad.
Got no time for those kind of games.
Nope. And she notices the stack of bills, like probably in bright red envelopes, you know, the ones they come in once they're overdue. And she says, "If you lack the ability to take care of such minor matters, I doubt you will be of any use to me." And at first he's just trying to get her to, like, give him a chance and listen to him. But once she starts to press him to do a soul gaze, then his suspicions start to be raised. And he tests her, finally. Her hands are sitting on the desk, and he pulls out a nail and rolls it towards her hands. And she waits until the very last second, but finally pulls her hands away. And it turns out that fairies cannot abide the touch of iron.
I feel like we heard that before in one of the earlier books. Did we not?
Yeah, he has a bunch of iron filings that he throws down Leah's dress.
Yes, that's right.
Which both of us were just kind of like, ew, come on, Harry. And yeah, she is outed. But rather than being annoyed by this, she's like kind of gratified to see that he's actually paying attention and putting the pieces
right.
together.
Right. So she's the one that's here to basically buy his debt.
Mm-hmm.
That he has to Leah.
Mm-hmm.
Which I don't know what kind of rules they have over there in the Fae.
Well, you know, she's like, she's the queen of winter. So whatever rules they have,
those are her rules.
You know, yeah, I think she can kind of, in many respects, probably not all, because being part of an elemental sort of, I'm sure there are things even she can't change.
Right.
But I bet that when it comes right down to it, the debt of anyone that she rules over probably is, in a way, her debt,
sort of
too.
It belongs to her anyway.
Yeah.
So it's just a matter of whether she wants to call it or not.
Mm-hmm.
And she has decided she's going to call this
mm-hmm.
shit. And because she wants Harry. What does she want him to do? She wants him to steal something back for her.
Well, she wants, like, she says that the thing that she wants to invest him to investigate is a murder that they don't believe is a murder. Like, she says, she gives him a file of a man that she claims was murdered, but she also says, I need you to exonerate me of it. So it's kind of, apparently she's being accused somehow, and says that something was taken as well. So there appears to be two levels to this. Oh my God, I forgot about this line. Because he says, I've had a rough time of things lately, to explain like how bad things look. And she says, you can't possibly know how little that matters to me. Which just, oh, I just love it so much. And I also like the detail that she had looked so beautiful before anyway, as a human being. But once she realizes that he knows what she is, she subtly changes how she reacts to everything and interacts with him, so that she's much more frightening all of a sudden. Like, she lets her human mask fall away.
Right.
He says, it was unsettling to see a face so lovely look so wholly alien, as though something lurked behind those features that had little in common with me and did not care to make the effort to understand. That blank mask made my throat tighten, and I had to work not to let the gun in my hands shake. But then she did something that made her look even more alien, more frightening. She smiled. A slow, cruel smile, as cruel as a barbed knife. When she spoke, her voice sounded just as beautiful as it had before, but it was empty, quiet, haunting. She spoke, and it made me want to lean closer to her to hear her more clearly. A cold shiver danced down my spine. So, yeah.
Yeah.
Queen Mab ain't nobody to fuck with.
She really isn't. And the fact that she's in, having this meeting with Harry, mm-hmm. part of me is like, oh, no.
Yep.
No, this is going to be terrible.
Harry is having the same reaction. Because initially, all he knows is that she is a fairy. That's right. It. And so he starts to just be like, you know what? I'm not fucking doing this. I'm not interested in making a deal with fairies again.
Yeah. I've already done this. I'm done. Not mm-hmm. doing it anymore. But, I can't wait to find out what her deal is with Leah.
I can't wait for you to find out either. And so when she tells him about how she bought his mortgage, so to speak.
Yeah, she foreclosed.
Right? And he's trying to be like, well, I don't have to do anything. She makes him open a drawer, pull out a letter opener, and drive it through his hand.
Yep.
And pin his own hand to the desktop.
Because you cannot fuck with the queen of the fae. Right?
Oh my God. I remember the first time I read this, I was like, it's not fair. It's not fair.
Right. And I feel like Harry should know this, but somehow.
I think that Leah's been too easy on him.
Oh, because remember in the last book when we first meet Leah, right? She seems super badass. You're like, how can it even get better or worse than this?
Yeah.
And then bam, next book, here you go.
Yep. Yeah.
Yeah, I feel like Leah's small potatoes compared to who we're meeting now.
I feel like as much as Leah seems like she is a like sociopath, cold-hearted in some ways, she's still like has an affection for Harry that restrains her a little bit. And Mab has no such affection.
Doesn't have it at all.
No.
Like, she's low-key mad she even has to have this conversation with Harry.
Yes.
She even needs his help. Like, she resents that.
Oh, God. And
I can't wait to find out why she needs him. Like, why wasn't there anyone else?
Yeah, that's a really good question. Why wasn't there anyone else?
Because she doesn't seem like she wants to be dealing with him or having this conversation with him or anything.
Yeah, I think dealing with mortals, period, is just not something she enjoys.
Her, right?
Yeah.
And here she is. So something must have happened to make this the reasonable choice. I can't wait to find out what it was.
And I love that he tries to pull the letter opener out of his hand, but instead his arm twisted, wrenching the letter opener counterclockwise.
Yep.
Like, she literally twists the knife on him.
I love that he thinks that he can do something about it.
Right.
And then he tries and it makes it worse because he is outmatched here.
Completely. Like, there's not even a contest.
And the way the books work, I'm sure at the end of this, something will happen and he'll be fine. But at this moment, he is completely outmatched and he should just be like, what can I do for you? What
yeah,
do you need?
I think that's fair. It's okay. So the pain flattened me. I wasn't even able to get enough breath to scream. The woman, the fairy, reached down and took my fingers away from the letter opener. She withdrew it with a sharp, decisive gesture and laid it flat on the desk, my blood gleaming all over it. Wizard, you know as well as I, were you not bound to me, I would have no such power over you. Yeah, this proves that this proves your ass is mine.
Pretty much. You thought she was just talking shit, but no, she was telling you the truth.
And she fucking like licks his blood up.
Oh my God, because she's gross and terrible. I didn't really need that, but I'm glad I got it.
So finally, the next chapter, when he realizes who she is, that more than her even getting to him to do what he did, realizing she's the queen of winter, that he almost shits himself. Like,
yeah. Well, because like, I feel like as wise as Harry is and as hip to all the goings and comings of the world, both on this side and the other side of the Never Never, there were some things that you feel like he just was not expecting.
Mm-hmm.
And this is one of those things.
Yeah. Yeah. Poor Harry. He just, you know, he's just not ready.
He's not. And you want to be like, oh, he just went through so much. Can't he just get a break? But you don't get a break because we have a whole new book starting. So there's no break for
indeed.
You.
So yeah, I swallowed a mouthful of fear, my eyes on the poisonously lovely fairy standing on the other side of my desk. It made Mab smile. Yes, she murmured. Wise enough to be afraid, to understand at least in part. How does it feel to know what you know, child? My voice came out unsteady and more quiet than I would have liked. Sort of like Tokyo when Godzilla comes up on the beach. Maybe she didn't like being compared to a 30-story lizard. Or maybe she did like it. Oh, I love it so much. And there's an interesting detail here where now he can look her in the eyes because he realizes that she doesn't have a soul. She's a fairy. So there's no soul gaze risk. But she was the one who had been suggesting that that's what they do. So she either can fake a soul gaze or she just wanted him to try it and then realize that it wasn't doing anything.
It didn't work. Yeah. Yeah. At first I thought that maybe she could get something from him while he got nothing from her.
Mm-hmm.
But reading this makes me think like it was just like calling his shit.
Yeah.
Yeah. I want you to do the soul gaze so you can see how meaningless it is.
Yeah.
Because then that will, you know, put him on uneven ground again.
Oh, Harry, you're never going to be on even ground with her. Doesn't matter.
I wonder, and I don't know yet, and I'll know later, because I still haven't read that much about the White Council and what the world is like on the other side.
Mm-hmm.
But he seems wholly unprepared for her. Like, he doesn't even know what she... He knows what she is, but he doesn't seem like he knows what she is.
You know what I mean? I don't think that he has any experience with Fairy outside of Leah.
Right. That's what I mean. Like, in my curiosity, because I haven't read it and I don't know, in my mind, Harry has met all different types of creatures on the other side.
Okay, I got you.
But when I'm faced with this moment, it's like, oh shit, no, he really hasn't. Maybe he's met one or two.
Or he's heard about them secondhand, you know? And so he thinks he knows.
Exactly. Like, I really was giving him credit for being much more personally knowledgeable of what existed on the other side.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't really have anything that to base it on, but I just kind of took Harry and his word. But now that his word's being challenged.
Yeah, you're going to learn not to take him at his word on some stuff.
Like, this motherfucker doesn't know what the fuck he's talking about.
Yeah. Yeah, Harry does a lot of growing.
Yeah, it's really good, though. I love it.
So what her offer is that after he completes 3 tasks for her, the whole thing is over. He would be completely free of any obligation to Fairy, period. And he has to negotiate it. But no matter how much he negotiates, it still ends with him feeling like he fucking fucked up.
Yeah, right.
So he tries to be like, okay, so I can decide which requests I fulfill and which I don't. If I refuse a request, there will be no reprisals or punishments. No more selling my mortgage or whistling up lackeys to chastise me or harass me by proxy. This remains between the two of us. And finally, he says, all right, we have a bargain.
Yeah.
When I said the words, a little frisson prickled over the nape of my neck down the length of my spine. My wound hand twitched in an aching, painful pang. Mab closed her eyes, smiling a feline smile with those dark lips, and inclined her head. Good. Yes.
Yes. This is not good. It's not good at all.
Oh my God. I love it. You know that look on Wile E. Coyote's face when he runs at full steam off the cliff and then realizes what he's done?
This was so good to listen to. I laugh so hard.
He doesn't look down, but he feels around with one toe. And right then, right before he falls, his face becomes drawn with a primal dread. That's what I must have looked like. But there was nothing else for him to do, really, in that moment. He did the best he could, you know. But what are you going to do?
Yeah.
So, she gives him an envelope with some photos in it of a body. And she says, within are the details of a man's death. I wish you to vindicate me of it by discovering the identity of his killer and returning what was stolen from him. So it's an old man. He's laying at a weird angle at the bottom of a flight of stairs. His name was Ronald Rule, and he was an artist. And yeah, that's about all he knows.
Yeah.
Harry asks why she's interested, and she just says there are powers of judgment other than mortal law. It is simply enough for you to know that I wish to see justice done. And she won't tell him what was stolen either. And he tries to act like he's not going to take this case necessarily, to which she just laughs in his face.
Yeah, I love that.
She tells the story of the scorpion and the spider.
That was really fun to listen to.
The Scorpion and the Spider. Or not. The Scorpion and the Fox. Yeah. Okay. Is this a metaphor for really awful constituents in our country at this moment? Yes, it is. Or is that just me? Basically, I'm going to vote against my own interests because fuck you.
Mm-hmm.
Even though I know it's going to, in the end, come back to haunt me, and I'm doing nothing good for myself or anyone.
When spite goes wrong.
It is in my nature. So that's what she tells him, because it's in your nature that you are most definitely going to take this case. Don't be stupid. I know you.
Right. Right.
And finally, she leaves, and it ends with the most unfortunate line. Maybe I'd been shut away in my lab too long, but Spencer never mentions that the fairy queen has a great ass. So I notice these things. So sue me. I will sue you. I will sue you.
You're going to get an angry letter, sir.
Dude, just can you not? Like, for a second?
He can't. Can't help himself. Can't help himself. yeah. So I'm excited for this book.
Yeah, this one's a good one.
Yeah, I really don't know where it's going. I could wager a guess on who the bad guy is, but I don't think it would be 100% sure. I feel like Leah, when she finds out that her debt has been taken and resold, she's going to be unhappy.
Hmm, okay.
But I don't know how much power she has against me, like whether she can do anything about it other than just sulk in the corner.
So you don't think that it was like an amicable handover? You think that it was just done without her
knowing? I think it was done. I feel like Maeve is in a position of power where if she decided she needed something from Harry, she would just be like, it's mine now.
Okay.
And because of whatever the hierarchy is over there, Leah is expected to acquiesce to it. And she might on the surface, but she also seems really petty. But I don't know how that would work. You know what I mean? Yeah. But I don't see her willingly and without grudge just being like, okay, you can have Harry. Because her desire to have Harry seems so perfect. So I'm curious. I'm really curious how that works out.
Oh, I'm so excited. This book is... And like the previous book is the one where the story gets going in terms of the vampire court war, you know, but this is the one where pieces really feel like they're being put in place. Like there are characters finally coming up that are important, and just some beats that I think are crucial. And I'm just excited to finally like kind of get into some of this real stuff.
And the vampire war is still a thing that's happening.
Oh, yeah.
Right? In that sort of the background. Like, it's in the first chapter, and then it kind of recedes a little bit. But that is a thing that's still happening for Harry in our world.
Most definitely.
So we've got, for the first time, I feel like, a couple of different fronts happening in the story.
Yeah, you know I mean, like, the hit against him was part of the vampire war.
Yeah, exactly. Like, there's that stuff that's happening on our plane or in the real world or whatever you want to call it.
Mm-hmm.
You have this thing with Maeve that's sort of in the never never, but it's clearly going to cross over into Harry's real world.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like things are moving on multiple cylinders for the first time, as opposed to the first three books where things have been kind of singular, you know?
Yeah, it's pretty much just rotated around Harry.
Yeah, like evolved. Everything has been on our plane. Like the last book was the first one that kind of did the crossover. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like there was the ghost in our world, but what was happening was something that was triggered on the Never Never. But this feels like shit's happening in Chicago where Harry lives, and shit is also happening on the other side of the curtain. And they're both equally important.
Yeah, him getting, like, people jumping out of a fucking truck and attempting to machine gun him down in the middle of a park in the middle of the day.
No.
A rain of toads happening, meanwhile.
Meanwhile? Like, we never even came back to that, but that's a good point. That is some shit that's happening. So yeah, I'm really excited to see how the story goes when it's like on all, like all the cylinders are running.
Mm-hmm. Agreed.
And I don't know if we get to it in this book, but it's mentioned briefly. Susan is still out there. Harry has clearly not given up on saving her in some capacity. So yeah, there's a lot going on. I'm excited.
Yay. I love this book series so much. Like, I just really do. I've been listening to all the audiobooks again, and I'm probably on the fourth time for most of them, and the fifth time on a couple of my favorites that I'm going back and listening to anyway.
Well, fingers crossed I get my hard copy, because just how I roll.
But I do encourage you to, like, read the chapters and then listen to the chapters.
I will. I will totally. I have, like, a month free of Audible before I have to cancel. I can't, like, go all the way through because, you know, I'm in
school. Sorry, hon, you went away again completely.
Oh, I said I have 30 days of Audible.
Oh, so right.
I can't, like, bang the whole book out because I have to be unspoiled, but I will try to listen to as much as I can.
Well, you have 30 days until you can cancel your membership, but when you cancel your membership, you still have the book.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, so...
Oh, that's good to know.
Yeah, so you'll have that book forever.
Oh, well... Excellent.
Well, yeah. I probably should set up an affiliate thing with Audible. I tried one time and it didn't seem to work, but I love Audible. Like the audiobooks and the way that it's set up is great. I love having the amazing Dropbox full of free books from Chris and from Bitches and Money, but they have this cool feature that I would love to try sometime called Whisper Sync, which if you're reading a book on your Kindle and listening to the audiobook, they each will automatically sync up to where you left off.
Ooh.
So if you put your Kindle down and go put your headphones on, the audiobook will figure out where you were in the Kindle and pick it up from there.
That's pretty savvy.
And that's like I was listening to Bag of Bones, which is coming up for the October book club, and going to the Kindle version that I had gotten from Money. And it was hard. Like I had to figure out where I had been and find my spot. And especially considering that it was like a copy that didn't have chapters demarcated in it. It was really tricky to find my place. So yeah, it's a pretty cool feature that I'd like to experiment on checking out. And yeah, guys, Bag of Bones, just finished it. That was much more of an intense book than I anticipated.
Oh, is that right?
I should have known.
Stephen King too?
Yeah, that's the one that I was telling you about yesterday.
Oh, right. That you messaged me about. Yeah.
And I finished it. I couldn't put it down. Like, I just, you know how he can be.
Did you ever read Beloved?
Mm-mm.
You should read that. Yeah, good. That actually might be a good podcast book, but I don't know if people be into it or not.
I've had it really on good. A list that people could choose from, and it didn't get got like middling votes.
I'm not surprised.
But it is something that I am interested in reading.
Yeah, if not even for the podcast, just for your own, I would highly recommend reading it. It's pretty good. Book is really good. The movie is meh, but the book's really really good.
Yeah, I should put that into my, because they have occasionally like freebies of really, really popular books on Kindle. I should have like an alert to see if I can figure out how to set that up for certain books like that, because I would like to read in my spare time. I'm trying to do a thing now where I read for half an hour before I go to bed and don't have my phone and don't do any chores and don't do anything. I just read and then I get up and I go to bed. It is really helpful the past few nights I've been doing it.
Yeah.
To like clearing my brain out a little bit. And it's made room for me to have time to read for pleasure, which is not something that I have been doing. I've been reading for the show and that's it. So I'm open to reading some other stuff that even isn't for the podcast. So.
Well, that would go right to my top of my list of suggestions.
All right. And yeah, everybody, Bag of Bones will be coming up in October, and I'm doing that one with the gentleman from Overdue Podcast, which if you guys don't listen to that show, you should, because they are hilarious. The tagline is overdue, the podcast about the books you've been meaning to read. And it's basically, they started out covering tons of classic books that people, like, the kind of things that when you are in literature majors in school, they assume that you've read.
That's right up my alley. Maybe I will check them out.
And then as the show's been on for longer, they've gotten past the point where they've covered most of those kinds of books. And now they take a lot of requests from patrons to read certain books. And sometimes they're recommending books that are just good books. And sometimes patrons recommend books to be kind of a shithead. And they recommend terrible things just to be like, let's see what you make of this garbage, which is also fun. But yeah, they're going to be joining me for Bag of Bones. I'm not sure if either of them have ever read it. I'm not sure if both of them will be reading it or if only one will, because often on their show, one of them reads it and explains the book to the other person, which is fun. But yeah, I'll be interested to see how it goes down. I'm really excited to talk about the book, period, because it was so interesting. But I'm also really excited to have them on the show because they're just fun dudes and I'm excited to talk to them. And I just wanted to say hi to patrons real quick because we weren't here last week. So we have a few. So welcome to Carrie DeWalt, Barbara Anderson, Amber Camacho, Caitlin Lavery, Jason S. Lewis, Leah Thompson, Katie Raken, Victor Chan, Gaby Mattis, Jack Landis, Nicole Jones, Sarah Wieland, Kristen Collins, Kimberly Slack, Slow 1990, Nick Leo, Jolie Slurm, Jason Lewis Lewis, and Leah Thompson all became patrons this past 2 weeks. So welcome to all of you guys. Thank you so much for becoming a patron. We love you. If you're $5 and up, you're going to be getting access to the Twin Peaks episodes that I'm doing with Maggie. And we just started season 3, which is the season that recently aired 25 years later, which is just crazy. And I'm really enjoying season 3 so far. Like season 2?
Are you?
Yeah.
Oh, cool.
Season 2 was quite a slog. The parts of the show that are so great are the weird shit that Lynch puts in. And it seems like...
he's a national treasure, so...
I mean, this guy's brain is out of control.
He does these weird commercials in Philadelphia. Like, they have this thing called, like, Philadelphia Supports the Arts. So whenever you have something that's going to be, like, the Kimmel Center or whatever, they'll have the person do a promo.
Okay.
And he's the one for this month. Oh, he's so weird.
Oh my God, I can't imagine.
He's such a weird dude.
He actually plays a character on Twin Peaks. And I like had a little bit of a crush on this weirdo character.
Oh my God, you're the worst.
David Lynch, when he was younger, was adorable.
He was.
And he has great hair.
Oh, he still has fantastic hair. You should see the bouffant on this guy.
Oh my God, it's insanity. I love
it. It's luxurious is what it is.
I can't help but wonder if it's even still real anymore. Like,
oh, it probably isn't. Don't say that.
I'm sorry.
Shut your mouth. Now that you mention it, it totally has. It can't be. Oh, I'm so upset right now.
I'm sorry.
God damn it.
But yeah, he came back because they were going to try and do season 3 without him. These fucking people.
Yeah, I remember watching that, yeah.
And the actors were all like, hi, season 2 was terrible because he wasn't involved enough. Like, we're not doing this show without him.
Yeah, they were all going to bail and he came back. Did you see him on Louie?
No, I haven't watched a lot of that show.
I want to say it was the last season or the second to last season it aired where he was doing the thing where he was going to get Letterman's job. And it was David Lynch, but he wasn't playing David Lynch. But it was fucking brilliant, even though my heart is broken about Lucy Kane.
Oh my God, don't get me started.
Yeah, I can't either.
Can't like anyone anymore, I swear to God.
Like, why do we even bother? But David Lynch was on that season, and it was fucking brilliant.
This season 3, they get right down in that weirdness immediately again. And it felt like David Lynch kind of was going, hey, remember when this show used to be about a grisly murder? How about we get back to that? Because season two, they just fucking like waffled around doing nothing, it felt like.
Yeah.
And
he was like, welcome back.
Yeah.
I know you've missed us.
He gets dark like right away, like in this intense way that I didn't expect to see at all. And it took me off guard, but I was here for it.
Yeah, he's so good. So, I don't know what bad to say about him.
Anyway, guys, if you want to hear about how I feel about season three, become a patron at $5 or more. You'll get immediate access. And then once I'm done with covering Twin Peaks altogether, patrons who are $4 and below will get access to all of the episodes once I'm done. So yeah, four and below, you only get access to completed patrons only series. Because I've had a few people have, you know, been confused about that. They joined at $1 and they tried to get access and couldn't understand why, and that's why. So you will get access eventually, but you just have to wait for it for a while.
Or,
what's that?
Said or.
Or you can become a $5 patron.
There you go.
Sean's like, marketing girl, marketing. Fix it.
Yeah, I'm all bold with you, but meanwhile.
true enough. So I think that's about all I wanted to mention this time. I'm pretty sure I'm forgetting something. Oh, for those interested, I did, for a birthday present for myself, because I'm going to be 33 on October 1st, I got myself the Akio box for Halloween.
Oh, did you? Good for you.
I did. I like saw that they were almost out of boxes and I was like, I've got to get it.
I'm not going to get a box. I wanted one, but it's not going to happen. Maybe next month.
You know, listeners, anybody out there who like wants to make Rashawn's dreams come true and get her a Halloween box.
Because Rashawn can't make her own dreams come true.
Listen, that's what we have, fairy godmothers out there. Hopefully not as horrible as Mab. But, you know, and people have done really sweet things. And you can gift Akio boxes. You can gift individual boxes and you can gift like a subscription for like a few months at a time. So, yeah, if anybody, you know, wants to do that, just, you know, go
sure
ahead.
Would be swell.
Go ahead. But I'm excited because I know at least one thing that they've teased for the Halloween box will be a pair of stemless wine glasses.
I know. I saw them and I wanted them so bad.
They're pretty cool. They have the dark mark on them.
Oh, I know. I saw. At least I'll watch your unboxing. You know, I'll live vicariously through you.
It would be pretty awesome. Like, if they weren't as fragile, I would love to bring them to Universal and drink out of them.
No,
with you, but
you save them at home and put them up in your special place.
I know, Mom. We probably could buy them at Universal, like a version of them.
Would they be as cool?
Probably it wouldn't be as cool.
Nope.
And they'd also be $40 each.
And they would be, wouldn't they?
Oh,
and they
God.
Wouldn't even come with wine in them. So
true. Yeah, we'd have to pay the hotel for wine. Like fucking rubes. But yeah, guys, check out akiobox.com and use code UNSPOILED to get 10% off your first 3 months. I think they're out of Halloween boxes by now, I'm pretty sure. But you can't use that code on the Halloween boxes anyway.
Yeah.
But use that code for your regular monthly boxes. UNSPOILED, 10% off. It's a really great way to support two small businesses, me and them. And the Akio box ladies are awesome, and I love them.
Yeah, they really are.
All right, I think that's everything. Anything you want to add?
No, ma'am.
All right, guys. Well, thank you so much for listening. I'm excited to be getting into this fourth book. Shit. And we will see you next week with three more chapters. Toodaloo, motherfuckers.
Bye, guys.
Was an UNSPOILED Network podcast.